really good show on the water because this whole talk is a concern. Before I get started, I just got this book the other day, and it's a compelling read.
Who's it by?
It's Barbara Ehrenreich, the same person that wrote Nickels and Dimes, another one that I hardly recommend.
Is that the real cover?
That's the real cover. Yeah, this land is their land, not their land.
That's a...
Excellent book. Okay, you'll notice that my title there is different than the title that's in your order of service, events and purpose. And the reason for that will become clear on my last slide. I promise that I'll finish in time for everybody to get to the master class this afternoon. Okay, incoming equality is at an unconscionable level, one of my favorite words, unconscionable. Well, how bad is it? See, there are the wealthiest 400 families get about $300 million a year. And I say get, not earn, because a lot of it is investment income. That, by the way, over the whole group is $120 billion a year. That's a lot of money. Now, this turns out to be $822,000 a day, which is $34,250 an hour, every hour, 24/7, 365, while they're sleeping. Now, that amount is 2.27 times 1 year at 725, the current federal minimum wage. Such an average family gets more in 3 days than most of us get in our entire working life. I've chosen 45 years and an average of $54,800 per year over your 45-year working life. You would just about make 2.5 years. More than most of us, I think. Now, the other side of inequality is poverty. The government defines a 100% poverty level for a household income. It's the same value nationwide. It doesn't vary by state. It only counts the number of people in the household. It doesn't distinguish between adults and children. That's based on an old assumption that people spend about one-third of their income on food. That turns out to be outdated. That assumption is. So, in the United States, the poverty, overall poverty level, adults and children, is about 15%. That's about 47 million people. You break it down and look at the children separately, 20% of them are in poverty, and of these 20%, almost half are extremely poor, which means they're in a household where the yearly income is less than one half, it's less than one half of the federal poverty level. That's shameful. The U.S. poverty level is 34th worst in a list of 35 industrialized nations. The only one we beat out was Romania. And they have an economy about 1/99 the size of ours, so weird. In the United States, the level goes from a low of, this is the latest figures I've got, 8.2% in New Hampshire, up to 22% in Mississippi. Oregon is right about at the average, 15.4. Puerto Rico, 46.1. This is a table, an abbreviated table of the poverty line as defined by the government. Households size 1 through 4 here. And I want to call your attention to this number right here. A family of, or a household size of 4, 100% is $24,600. And if you're working at the federal minimum wage, you need to work 3,393 hours to get that. That's more than a year. Year and a half. If you're working at the Oregon minimum wage, which on July 1st will be 10 and a quarter, then you'll have to work 2,400 hours. I'm going to show later some estimates of the budget for what they modest but decent life, a start for a living wage. And it turns out those living wages are all between 2.5 and 3 times the poverty level. So if you apply that, apply the 2.5 to that 2,400 there, you get 66,000. Now, if you have both people working, that's 3 person years, 6,000 hours. If you have both people working, they're each working 60 hours a week. So where is there any family time? It's impossible. Well, how does poverty affect society? Living in poverty is trauma. Trauma for everybody. You have one parent, a single parent perhaps, or both parents working long hours, multiple jobs, probably all part-time, all kinds of weird schedules. They're able to afford only the bare minimum of everything. They're always on the edge, constant stress. The children are the most traumatized. Stressed parents behave in ways that actually damage the children. It rewires their DNA, their brains. They can suffer physical and emotional neglect, parental substance abuse, domestic violence, homelessness, domestic breakup. These kinds of things, when they affect children, are called adverse childhood experiences. The children, the brains of young children are very plastic, and stress can change the brain chemistry in such a way that it actually modifies the DNA. In the children themselves, it causes something like PTSD, and they have emotional volatility, difficulty concentrating, they don't learn very well, and they get in trouble with the law, following directions, persisting in a task. Health consequences are strongly correlated with a lot of later life problems like obesity, heart problem, diabetes. Part of this is caused because the damage that is done causes these kids to make poor choices if they get older. That's true. They have difficulty getting and holding a job, and trouble with the law, and are likely to end up incarcerated. Furthermore, the effects can be passed on to the next generation because the DNA has been modified, it's genetically passed on. So the current generation of parents are probably, very likely, suffering from ACEs themselves, and they pass this to their children, and their children will pass it to their children. So it will go down the generations, and it will make it very difficult for anybody in this family to get out of poverty. Now, there are exceptions. We have a book that we've read called Born Bright, where a woman, yeah, there it is, that's another book that I highly recommend. That book details what she goes through in a dysfunctional, impoverished household, and how she has to work so hard to get out. She does it. But it's not something that everybody can do. The effects of ACEs can be mitigated if children get attention, loving care, family time, and also if there's an intervention by trained people that will educate both parents and children as to what constitutes healthful living. This is done when your children would be happier, they would perform better in school, be more productive adults. All this requires reduction in work hours so that the family does have time to get together. And this requires a living wage. As an aside, this intervention I'm talking about would be an investment in the children. It would be funded by the government, but it would be an investment. And the return on an investment is very high, between $7 and $8 for every dollar you put in, according to some studies that I've found. So what do I mean by a living wage? I mean one person working 40 hours a week, able to support his family. To have a second person work, who would be a choice, not a necessity. I also would include paid time off, family vacations, family care. People aren't machines. They shouldn't be treated like machines. So where would we start? We have online computer models that will calculate this. I can give you links to websites. You can go through and do some of these calculations yourself. Just plug in the city or the area, and it'll come out with and the family size, number of adults, number of children. And you'll get a result that's specific to your area. Well, it may not be. I couldn't fly in Florence, for instance. Florence had to be a category rural Oregon. But I could find Eugene. And for Eugene, it was pretty close to that 2.5 I'm talking about, the 2.7 actually, for a family of four. So what they include is food, housing, childcare, health care, transportation, other necessities, which include just your household items, your clothing, things you have to buy in order to live decently, and transportation, get to work. And they also include the taxes. And by including the taxes, that they back calculate the total you would have to earn. I'll rephrase that. They first calculate everything but taxes. Then they use the tax rate to back calculate how much you would have to earn before taxes in order to end up with the proper amount. These calculations don't include savings for retirement. And, as I said before, the results come out 2.5 to 3 times the federal poverty level for the same household size. Okay, even bigger, you can't see this one very well.
You can take the handheld microphone, John, take the handheld microphone on the chair.
Where?
And just turn it on.
Turn it on?
Yep.
Hello? Is this on?
Yeah, it's working.
Okay. I hate this. Okay, two big items. Child care, top line. Be $1,000 a month, $12,000 a year. That means if you had a two-person family and one chooses to work and has to pay for child care, that's a whole federal poverty line income for one person. So if it happens you don't have to have the second parent work, you don't have to pay child care, that's about $12,000 less that the worker has to earn. Another biggie is housing. And I looked at my Eugene results. Starts out here, that's 643 for one person, then it goes up to 817 for a two-bedroom apartment, and for a three-bedroom, 1,100 a month. I looked in the Eugene paper, and I was hard-pressed to find anything that inexpensive. So a lot of the two-bedrooms were 2,000. So things have been gentrified, that's one of the problems. Okay, the living wage, if both work, is in this line here. It goes from $9.50 up to $20. And the multiplier, how much more these expenses are at the federal poverty level, is in the bottom one. So.
No.
Oh, okay. I'll leave this one out just in case.
My bad.
So, living wage is a moral imperative. Businesses should not be able to build into their business model the idea that they can pay starvation wages and have the government pick up the slack. subsidies to these companies for underpaid workers was $153 billion in 2016. And about 60,000 of that is food stamps, or SNAP. But the new name for food stamps is SNAP, Supplementary Nutritional Assistance Program. The children are damaged and denied a chance for a productive and happy life, and their children also suffer. Poverty is expensive. It's tough. The system is rigged, just like Elizabeth Warren said. It's rigged. Poor people have to spend more, relatively, for the same things that other people with more money can get for less. And an example given in Barbara Ehrenreich's Nickel and Dimed is minimum wage workers working, living in a flea bag motel that they can't even get people to stay in anymore, so they rent it out by the week to very poor people. The weekly rent turns out to be twice as much per week as it would be if they could rent by the month. But they can't rent by the month because they can never accumulate first and last month's rent. That's one way. It's a trap. It's a trap in how they have to buy their food, and it's a trap in how they have to transport themselves. Again, with the gentrification, they usually have to live far away from their jobs and then take public transport, or if they have a jalopy, they can drive back and forth. But it's expensive, especially if they're working part-time at multiple jobs. They got to drive all over the place. So, and all of this is all the more important than our current, in my opinion, immoral administration. The living wage is also a good business. Workers will have more money to spend, and the money will go back into the economy quickly. Give money to somebody who's wealthy, they're like this. Won't go back into the economy. Give it to someone who's been on the edge and now has enough to spend a little more, he's going to spend it. And that benefits all the businesses. In addition, you'll have better employee morale and less turnover. Now, when we had a business in Las Cruces, we did pay people the living wage, and we had almost zero turnover. And we gave them insurance and vacation, and I will say that we saved one person's life because she had a problem that she probably would not have seen a doctor for without the insurance until it was too late. So she would have died probably of cancer. I mean, that's speculation, but I think there's a pretty good probability. Children will be better students. They'll have less crime and incarceration. And incarceration is a very expensive way to keep
housing people.
It costs a lot more to live in jail than it does outside. But it's the government. You and I have been paying for that. Then finally, the safety net outlays will be reduced, while taxing revenues will increase. These people will earn more. They'll pay more taxes. And then we can have money for more or other urgent needs like infrastructure. Maybe we won't have to sell off everything in order to get enough money to run the federal government. I don't know if anybody saw the paper this morning, but Trump wants to sell the Bonneville Dam Association.
Yeah.
He wants to privatize it. Says it'll give $4.9 billion over the next 10 years, which seems to me pretty meager. It should stay the way it is. Okay. If I present this to people like chambers of commerce, I'm going to get objections. And I need rebuttals. The first and most common objection is even raising the minimum wage, let alone going to a living wage, costs jobs. Well, the study by the National Employment Law Project shows no correlation between minimum wage increases and employment levels, and they extended their data over the last 7 decades. Yes, there's little bumps here and there, but overall, are several successful firms already pay above the minimum wage.
The one that we have access to here is Costco, and they pay $21 on the average. It's not quite a living wage for a large family size, but better than a lot of people. Ben and Jerry's $16 entry level. I couldn't get their average, but it's probably higher.
And that was based, according to what I read, that was based on a living wage for Vermont.
So there are some companies there that are at least trying to act in a reasonable manner.
Other objections? Well, low-skilled workers don't deserve higher wages.
They tend to blame the poor on their own situation. And you're poor because you made bad choices, not because you were born into it. And the big problem here that I see with the kids is they don't make bad choices. They're kids. They're born into this. They don't have any choice, yet they suffer the most. That's what's really important about it.
Says they get paid what they're worth in the market. They can get what else they need from the government. Well, in the first place, everyone that's born deserves to live. So if they aren't paid enough to live, then that should change. Furthermore, poverty still persists, even in the presence of all these safety net programs. They don't give enough to raise you out of poverty. They just let you survive a little bit. And the benefits are meager. At best, they're means tested, and they vary widely by state. Stay out of Alabama. The philosophy there is zero benefits, and they hand their staff out zero candy bars to symbolize this. Let's see. I'd like to say something here. They can get what they need from the government. It turns out that 18% of all the food stamp money goes to Walmart employees. 18%. This is probably well known. They hand out applications for all of the safety net programs to their new hires. And that's how much they're costing us, just for food stamps.
Biggest employer.
Pardon?
They're the biggest employer.
And they're the biggest employer. Shoot, they're almost a country unto themselves.
Okay, how do we get this done? Legislating probably isn't going to work. We're going to get the usual objections of its government overreach. They have all kinds of arguments.
And
the fact that living costs vary widely by locality means that if you did pass a law, it would have to be a very complex law. And if you pass a law in this country, especially when it affects business, the first thing they do is look for ways to get around it. They don't look for ways to follow.
So we have to convince business that paying a living wage is good business. Now, there are some bright points here. I'll get to.
So my plan is to convince chambers of commerce that paying a living wage is a good business, and I'd like to do this eventually at locations across the country, and I'm planning on reaching out to the UUA and see if they would help by in the individual cities across the country having one or more of their people go out and give a presentation to chambers of commerce. And what I would present is a Powell memo type document. You know about the Powell memo?
Oh, yeah.
1971, William Powell sent out a memo addressed to chambers of commerce, and it was meant to be passed on to their client businesses, warning them that business was losing control of the U.S. economy. All kinds of catastrophes were happening, and he seemed to focus on the nasty students at Berkeley and other places like that that were out in the streets protesting this and that. And he convinced the chambers, who convinced the businesses, and they started cracking down. It's been going on ever since. Another thing I thought of was to push for a law that would penalize by a tax companies that in accord with how much of the safety net funds their employees get because of the low wages. And there you can see 18% of SNAP to Walmart employees. If you pay a living wage, you don't get taxed. And I plan to talk to our legislators about that, pull this idea with our congressman. On a hopeful note, this has already been tried. At least they tried to pass it in Connecticut in 2014. They had an act that they called Concerning the Recoupment of State Costs Attributable to Low-Wage Employees. It didn't pass in that year, and I haven't found any more information about it, but I'm going to look some more. So maybe that tax idea is possible. Another hopeful note is that I discovered a website just this past week. It's called Business for a Fair Minimum Wage. And this is a site devoted to higher wages as being good for business. Now they're talking about higher minimum wages. They're not talking about living wages, but at least the mindset is there that maybe people should be paid more. Over 1,000 businesses have currently signed on to this. We support a stepwise increase of the minimum wage. Not what we want, but it's a start. While I'm on the topic of minimum wages, we know that, that Sanders and Murray have introduced a bill to raise the minimum wage in this country, the federal minimum wage, in steps up to $15 an hour, but I think 2024. I did a little bit of mathematics. Looked at the minimum wage since 1957, when it was $1 an hour. And over the intervening years up to today, the way the data plots out, the average increase in minimum wage per year, it hasn't been done uniformly, it's been done in fits and starts, but it's about 4%. And it turns out that the Sanders-Murray bill, if you extrapolate that line out to 2024, it's 4%. So all they're doing is keeping up it has to be done, but I don't call it revolutionary. Okay, I got a slide here which you probably don't need to go into. It's the reasoning that businesses for fair minimum wage apply. They do say it reduces the growing strain on our social safety that's caused by inadequate wages. We can go over that some more in the questions and answers. The next step is to get feedback. That's where you guys come in. And revise this whole approach accordingly and prepare a written document and send that out to the UUA and the UU Voices of Justice and anybody else that might be interested. Try to get before the Chambers of Commerce that are here and there to make the case. Talk to our congressman. One final slide. This is the reason for the change in the name of the talk, the change in the title. The Fed is under what is called the dual mandate. And the dual mandate says something like, in order to keep inflation under control, you have to have a certain amount of unemployment. Yeah, that's right. And their sweet spot is the center there. It's about 2% inflation at about 4.7% unemployment. Where we actually are is less on the inflation side and less on the unemployment side. It was about 4.3 the last time. But what bugs me about this is it means that the government expects 4.3% of the workers to be unemployed. And it's built into the system. So I think something has to be done about this. Now, you can't talk about wages, they're not working. But the concept of a basic income has been floated in Europe and here, mostly in Europe, that would give people in dire circumstances of basic income that they could live on. And I think we're going to have to include this consideration.